She's on her way here.
Initially, Andrew came to us and he said, look, I'd like to have a crowd of, you know, 1,000 to 5,000 creatures. And it's our job to figure out how to achieve that with the most realism and the highest quality, but still being able to deliver it in the time and the budget that they're looking for. Part of what we have to decide is exactly how many unique creatures do we need to make up a crowd of 1,000. Some people would actually think you'd need 1,000 creatures. You don't actually need 1,000 creatures, but you need a lot more than 10. So part of the trick is finding out just exactly how many you need. We came up with about 30 unique creatures, 120 unique individuals, we would say. And when we start creating a shot, our process basically is the layout artists will take these creatures. They have a scan from the set, which gives the 3D topology of the ground surface. And they'll lay out the crowd pretty much how they think it should be.
Try and take him then.
There were days where I was on set and going, how are we gonna do this? We have, you know, 85 creatures. I don't know how we're gonna do it. And we gotta start at 2 a.m. and I gotta have everybody on set by 6 and crazy locations, and some we had to be helicoptered in and, you know, bring all these centaurs and goblins and minotaurs and all this crazy stuff up in the helicopters. And, you know, then add in the digital, you know, aspect of it. That's what's kind of cool about the whole thing. It's not all digital, it's not all practical. It's a huge combination, you know, and there's a lot of augmentation to our stuff.
Enough. I shall talk with you alone.
What's unique about this film is how closely all of the departments ultimately had to work together and how intertwined we all were. Between visual effects and sets and costumes, we all constantly talk to each other about how our part influenced their work and how their work influenced ours, but specifically with creatures and makeup effects. We were locked at the hip with them every day. Ultimately, it became our and Andrew's interaction with all of the cast to make sure their movements were true to life for these CG portions of their characters, because it was their movements, their performance ultimately that would make the scene work or not.
When Aslan strikes the deal to give his own life in trade for Edmund, what's interesting is the dialogue plays out in some ways in a very aggressive manner.
She has renounced her claim on the son of Adam's blood.
How do I know your promise will be kept?
Even when he comes out after making the deal, he still has to present himself as having in some ways won the argument, Edmund's life is saved, and never give away the fact that it was in trade for his own life. And yet we need to let the audience in on that. And in some ways, drop the facade just momentarily and allow the audience to peek in. And that's a really interesting thing, obviously heavily based around staging, but really around the acting choices. There's a moment where he drops his guard and we allow Lucy in, but we let the audience in one shot earlier, which is really interesting. You know, and then it cuts to Lucy. It's a nice piece of filmmaking, I have to say.
My approach to the movie is that it's real. That Narnia is a real world, and that world has to be believable. The audience has to believe that Aslan is first and foremost a real lion. He's a talking, emoting, incredibly powerful, incredibly, you know, intelligent creature, but he is a lion. He looks like a lion. He has all the awe and fear that a lion brings. You want to approach it, and at the same time, it could bite off your hand. And I've had this experience. I've petted one in absolute fear, but I couldn't resist petting it. And I want the audience to get that from Aslan.
You have to believe it's a real lion. You have to, his movement, all the secondary, we call it secondary animation, when a character takes a step or two, and you see the muscles jiggling, and you see the fur dynamics moving back and forth with each step. And the wind's blowing and it's moving the hair and the mane, you know, slightly differently than maybe the hair in the back of the mane or on the back of the lion.
Shouldn't you both be in bed?
We couldn't sleep.
Please, Aslan. Couldn't we come with you?
I would be glad of the company for a while. Thank you.
I think we've pushed the envelope on Aslan. I've never seen a digital character push this far before. He has 1,400 controls in him. 700 of those are just in his face alone. So there's a lot of control there, but it's amazing that that's actually the reduced control set. That's probably, you know, I would say maybe a tenth of the number of controls that are all in there, but they're all packaged together and pared down into these easier to use controls, more streamlined controls that make it easier to animate with.
From here, I must go on alone.
But Aslan...
You have to trust me.
A control is an object in our animation package that an animator would grab and manipulate it in order to move a character around. Things like rotations, being able to take a limb and rotate it. They would have a control to rotate an elbow. They'd have a control to rotate a wrist or to translate a wrist around through space. And we have controls for the face where they're just simple sliders, where they'll run a slider and it'll just lift a lip or it'll tweak a lip or bring a wrinkle out. It gets down to very fine levels of detail, like he'll actually have an inner brow control, a middle brow control, an outer brow control, because if he wants to raise an eyebrow, it's not the same brow raise every time.